Well, enjoy. Enjoy. And again, apologies for the non-gender music. Well, you know, not sensitive to the gender. So we'll go now. If I can get across to it, I'm going to go take you now to our three songs, and then you'll see me come back again. Okay, so just enjoy. You can sit, you can sing along, seeing as you're muted. We won't be able to hear you. Stand, play around, do whatever you want to do, but just enjoy it. Thank you.
Songs of intercession and praise. Heavens tonight, open our eyes to make us more aware of Him tonight as we sing to Him.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart, I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart, I want to see you. I want to see.
We will stop at nothing to protect the health of New Yorkers and the health of the people of our country in their hour of need. And with the grace of God, we will win this war and we will win this war.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
Open the eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Open my
open
eyes.
The eyes of my heart. I want to see you.
Our prayer, God.
I want to see you.
Open my eyes, Lord.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
To see you.
To see you high and lifted up. Shining in the light of the glory, pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy.
To see you
high and lifted up, shining in the light of the glory, Lord, pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
Open our eyes, Lord.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Open my
open
eyes.
The eyes of my heart. I want to see you.
Lord, I
want to see you. To see you high lifted up, shining in the light of the glory. Lord, pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy.
To see you
high lifted up, shining in the light of the glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. To see you high and lifted up as the shining of the light of the glory.
Pour out
your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy.
I want to see you. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see you.
Let's worship with these words.
Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see you.
You are
holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see you.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. You're rich in love and you're slow to anger. Your name is great and your heart is kind. For all your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to find. So bless the Lord, oh my soul. Soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. Bless you, Lord. on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Forevermore. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never. Worship your holy name, Lord, I worship your holy name. Sing like never. Worship your holy name, Jesus, I will worship your holy name, worship your holy name.
Welcome back, everybody. I skipped one of the songs, in case you've probably already gathered. Seeing as we had three of them, I've just chosen two because they're quite long. I want to read to you Psalm 23 from the Passion Version, and I want to read it as a meditation. So I'm going to pause between some of the, some of the verses and some of the phrases and help you, allow you to be able to just meditate on those. So Psalm 23 from the Passion Version. The Lord is my best friend and my shepherd. I always have more than enough. He offers a resting place for me in his luxurious love. His tracks take me to an oasis of peace, the quiet brook of bliss. That's where he restores and revives my life. He opens before me pathways to God's pleasure and leads me along in his footsteps of righteousness so that I can bring honor to his name. Lord, even when your path takes me through the valley of deepest darkness, fear will never conquer me, for you already have. You remain close to me and lead me through it all the way. Your authority is my strength and my peace. The comfort of your love takes away my fear. I'll never be lonely, for you are near. You become my delicious feast, even when my enemies dare to fight. You anoint me with the fragrance of your Holy Spirit. You give me all I can drink of you until my heart overflows. So why would I fear the future? For your goodness and love pursue me all the days of my life. Then afterward, when my life is through, I'll return to your glorious presence to be forever with you. Amen. We're going to have a Bible reading now, and I'm going to turn over to Jesse. Jesse, let me just...
Shall I check everyone can hear me? Do I need to raise my voice? So, reading from John chapter 9. As he, Jesus, walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?" Jesus answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, "Go, wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. Then he went and washed and came back able to see. The neighbours and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, "Is this not the man who used to sit and beg?" Some were saying, "It is he." Others were saying, "No, but it is someone like him." He kept saying, "I am the man." But they kept asking him, "Then how were your eyes opened?" He answered, "The man called Jesus made mud, spread it on my eyes, and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' Then I went and washed and received my sight." They said to him, "Where is he?" He said, "I do not know." They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees also began to ask him how he had received his sight. He said to them, "He put mud on my eyes, then I washed, and now I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not observe the Sabbath." But others said, "How can a man who is a sinner..."
We've lost you, I think, Jesse. You've paused. So that's probably enough. I'm going to mute you, Jess. I'm not sure what happened there, but your computer's frozen. Can everybody hear me? Just wave if you can hear me. Thank you. That's good. I'm sure Jessie will come back online shortly. She got almost through the whole of the reading anyhow, and I gave her the whole of chapter 9 to read, so it was quite a long reading. I think we've got to be aware when we read John's Gospel that some of the stories that are in John's Gospel are considered enacted parables. So they're not necessarily just a story that was on the news, you know, like we have a news story coming to us. It's got greater meaning because the Gospel of John is in fact a spiritual gospel, and it was intended for us not to just read it in that sort of literal sense, but to be able to see more into it and to see hopefully some spiritual, enlightenment from these scriptures. So with this scripture, I believe it's about being enabled to be enlightened. So as the fellow received his sight, he was not, this is descriptive of not just being able to see his sight, seeing things around him, but having an inner seeing. And when we view it from that perspective, we get all sorts of, I guess, additional things. So as I've done before on different occasions, I like to look at things, from a general perspective, and then I like to look at it from the way people read things or people's reactions to stories. Then I like to go into, well, what does it say about Jesus? And then finally, what does it say about us or to us? So just generally, we know that it was on the Sabbath. So we know that this, first of all, was a challenge to anyone who had any religious sensibilities at all. If they've been living in that environment in which Jesus was at that time, the church or the synagogue or the temple, really, what we'd call church, of course, but had the rule and regulation for everybody. It was telling them what to do. And it was the greatest authority. And so when we have somebody doing something incorrect, it was an affront to both the people and also to God. So what is Jesus actually doing when he comes and does something against God or apparently against God on the Sabbath? In fact, I believe what he's doing is trying to establish himself as Lord of the Sabbath. And so that's probably one of the things that we can gain from here generally. And then he's faced, all the people there were faced with moral and a physical challenge. So he, the man particularly, was faced with a physical challenge because his eyes were closed and they needed to be opened. But everybody was faced with this moral dilemma. Suddenly, there's something that appears good is happening to this man, and yet it's on the Sabbath, so it's incorrect. So how do you justify that? How do you work through that if you're a religious person, part of the temple, or wanting to follow God? I think another thing that happens too is that some people then become selfish. So we look at these are people generally, that things that happen. I'm not responsible. And you see that in the fellow's parents. It's like, well, first of all, Jesus says nobody's responsible. That the disciples are trying to work out, well, who's responsible for this? You know, somebody must be responsible for this man being blind in the first place. And Jesus goes, no, nobody is responsible. It's got nothing to do with those sorts of issues. Don't try and categorize it into these sorts of things. And I think that's what we tend to do today. Even looking around us at the situation that we've been through fires, we've been through floods, we're now in this coronavirus, and I know a lot of people, you might not be, but I know a lot of people are trying to find blame. I've heard people say, oh, Satan's done it. It's Satan's work and we need to do this to counter it. Well, what's Jesus saying here? He's saying, no, this is not Satan's work. This is nobody's work. This is just, this man is born blind to be able to show Jesus' power as Christ. So Jesus was demonstrating through this scripture how he is powerful and all powerful and in fact is God incarnate. So that's what he's trying to get across to the people. So we don't need to become selfish and just go and, you know, tell others that it's ours. We don't need to blame anybody either who sinned, him or his parents. And we don't need to hide also from our fears. Now, our fears are usually, we have secondary emotions often from our fears. And I've seen a lot of this happening, as you've seen that fights for toilet paper in the supermarkets, whether you've seen them yourself or on the news. But it's just ridiculous. And people get angry and they don't even realize that what it is that's creating them to be angry is in fact their fear. So it's one of those, anger. A lot of people just hide. Other people, express it in lots of different ways. So some people eat more. Some people don't eat. Some people sleep. And then try and, you know, pretend that these things aren't happening and hopefully they'll just go away. But whatever it is, this is what people do. And this is what was happening in that story. People were reacting in all of these ways, emotional. They were thrown by the whole thing and they just couldn't comprehend what was going on. We hopefully have a greater insight. Hopefully we've gotten to the point where we now know that this is a more spiritual way of looking at things. Okay, so what does the story tell us about Jesus? We've already mentioned that it tells us a little bit about him being Lord of the Sabbath, which then means that he must be God because God was Lord of the Sabbath. But Jesus says in this scripture, I'm the light of the world. Right, what's that light? Obviously, it's not a globe or it's not the sun, S-U-N. It's something greater and deeper. And I would sort of, I just hazard a guess. I think what he's trying to say is he enlightens people. We can be enlightened within our own being, individually and corporately, from Jesus, when we allow Jesus to really function in our life. Not just say, I believe in Jesus, but to function fully in our lives. Jesus raises us beyond our circumstances as well. We're not stuck in the circumstances, although it might appear that we are. This fellow had, he was in his circumstances. He got rocked. Imagine what it must have been like to be this fellow. He didn't have a job and he was just basically begging. He would have been a beggar or he would have been looked after by somebody. But then suddenly Jesus comes on the scene and he can see. So what then is expected of this fellow? He would obviously be expected to then look after himself. He's probably got no training because if he was blind from birth, he's got no skills whatsoever. So what's he going to do? He's sort of stuck. And it's like, is it better that he was, and he probably would have considered this, would it have been better for him to stay blind and be looked after? Or was it better that he was enlightened, being able to see the power that was coming into him? And then even though this enlightenment created more problems for him. So he now, this fellow, had to deal with what Jesus had done for him. Something good had happened to him. But was it? And how is he going to cope now? He knows the truth. He's seen truth. He's seen the power of God and he's experienced the power of God in his life. What's he going to do with it? And how's he going to cope with it? How's he going to run his life with this? It's a challenge for him, but it's also a challenge for us. The more that when Jesus comes to us in this capacity, when Jesus enlightens our soul, enlightens our spirit, there's no turning back. You can't say it didn't happen. You can't say, well, but you can say, what do I do now? And there's a whole new life that's not necessarily full of, you know, roses and you know, sunlight. There are some downtimes. There's lots of struggles. You know, I know I'm diverting a little bit here, but over the last couple of weeks, I've noticed that people have been facing moral struggles. I noticed that some people that I know, or one particular person that I know, shared with me that they had to visit someone who was in hospital, or they wanted to visit someone who was in hospital. They were in ICU, and yet the person that I was talking to thought they had the virus. So, but this person they wanted to visit was in fact very close to them. And they thought, I'm not going to be able to say goodbye to this person unless I go in and with this virus. But what they didn't realize, that coming into the hospital, what they didn't realize rather, that's because that's what they were sharing to me, that coming into the hospital, they were putting lots of other people at risk. They were putting nursing staff and doctors and other, maybe potentially other patients, even though it was in ICU. They weren't gowned up, but they made that decision against with a struggling morality to it. I see people in shopping centres that are either in denial or they're masked up. Sometimes they can't just stay home. There's all sorts of things that have been happening that I'm aware of anyhow, just in the last short while. But I think when Jesus comes into our life, coming back to this, he raises us above those circumstances. He gives us the ability to be able to consider all of the morality, but not only that, to be able to live a life that's different and more empowered. So we're looking to how, this is what we're told, Jesus changes us. Jesus changes, therefore, the situations around us and the way that we view situations. So what's the story say about you individually? What type of story is this? Can you move beyond your fears? I'm sure that most of us have a degree of fear of some sort, and most of us would have, I'm included myself here, most of us would have the fear manifest in certain ways, and only you would probably know how your fear gets manifested. Anger, exhaustion, ignoring excuses, back pain, stomach problems, weight loss, weight gain, addictions, more smoking, alcohol, whatever, and then relationship issues. These are just some of the things, plus many more, that happen as a consequence of our fear. So are we able to, as enlightened people of God, that this story is talking about, how do we deal with these things? How do we deal with them? And can we raise ourselves above and beyond this? And can you, here's another question for you, can you move beyond the religious rules of the past? Here we are today and we're meeting online. We're not able to touch each other. We've been restricted by the government to not meet in large groups or even small groups for that matter. And yet we've got to do something with that. What do we do with it? We move beyond our circumstance. That's what we've done. That's what you've all done today. You've moved beyond your circumstance. But how do we deal with it? Do we then go back to the past after this is all over? And then we have to consider, is this the 21st century? Is this the new way things might be or can be or you would like them to be? Or do we do a combo of both? Do we do meetings together once it's all over? But do we then continue on with the technology? I know we've been talking as a church for a long while that we want to move forward. We want to move forward where society is going. And it's almost as if this is giving us an opportunity to do that. Yes, it's fast-tracking. It's a bit scary. It's like, yeah, challenging. It's got all of those challenges, just like that guy was with the guy that got healed of his blindness. It has challenges from here on in. Is this the Christian way? Is this the spiritual way of being? Should we be doing these sorts of things? Do we set those things, those old habits of Christianity back in the background and just leave them to be? Are you able to do that? And are you able to assess that according to where you believe Christ would have you? And are the things in your life always somebody else's fault? I don't know. You may well have been going, oh, well, what created this? Who caused this? It's, you know, I don't know. That's just up to you. But check yourself. Are you thinking all the time somebody else is, you know, in control of this or did this to me? It's not my fault. I didn't do it. And then again, can you enter this new consciousness? Can you allow Christ to take you to the next step? The next step of your faith. Are you willing to go there? No matter what the circumstance, no matter what might come, just like the difficulties that that blind fellow encountered moving forward, are you willing to take whatever happens? Are you willing to go there, even if it's much, much more uncomfortable or even horrible than what it has been? And only you will know that. And are you bound by your circumstances? Is God trying to wash away your blindness so that you can see? John Thornton said in his latest newsletter, perhaps this is a God moment for the church, an opportunity for us to be open to new thinking and new things that might just herald in a new time, a new way, for us to be the salt of the earth and the light of the world. I thought that was just wonderful. It's a healing and restoration time. So where are you with it all? Where would you like to be and where do you want to go into the future? And finally, what did the man in the story do when he could see? Where was he found? He was found in the temple. That's where he went. And what will you do once you can see? Let's pray. God of enlightenment, God, you enjoy us so much as we read in Psalm 23. You love us so much. We know you want only good for us. Help us to follow your path so that you are the light, not just of our path, but of our inner being. Help us to be courageous to step into that new place of enlightenment so that we might not look back, but only look forward to where you would have us and where you would lead us. And bless it to all of us in Jesus' name. Amen.
I am down, and oh, my soul so weary. When troubles come, let my heart burden be. And I am still and wait here in the silence until you come and sit a while with me. You raise me up so I can't stand on mountains. You raise me up to walk on stormy sea. I am strong when I am on your shoulders. You raise me up to more than I can be. When I am on your shoulders, you raise me up to more than I can be.
A little bit at the moment, as you're well aware. We've got still got a church, we've got buildings, we've got all sorts of different things, but we've got no income coming in. And I don't want to ponder on that, but I just want to bring it to your attention that perhaps we need to think in new ways of how we're going to take care of our buildings and our people. And we have lots of people working that are on wages, such as people in the synod, etc., etc. So I just want to give this to God just now whilst we're all together and ask God for some sort of insight and some help through the situation. So, God, you supply everything. You have supplied all of the good things that we encounter on a daily level. Lord, the system of this world, as you're well aware, is money. Unfortunately, we don't like it. You said, render to Caesar what's Caesar and render to God what's God's. At the moment, it's a bit confusing for us. We need to be able to take care of your people and your buildings and your all of the things that we are committed to. But we don't know how we're going to do that. So, Lord, enlighten us, just like you enlightened that fellow in John 9. Enlighten our spirits with creative thinking, imaginative thinking, ways of being able to do things for you and for others in ways that if they require finances, they require finances. Help us to know how to go about this and what to do. We offer this to you to be able to inspire our hearts in Jesus' name. Okay, I want to read a prayer to you for the people. You might be able to join with me if you get it. The joining with me part is, Lord, we look to you today. Lead us, we pray. Lord, we look to you today. Lead us, we pray. Lord, we're in challenging times. Things are changing so quickly. We are unsure what to do or where we can go or what we still hold and what we've got to cancel. Lord, we look to you today. Lead us, we pray. Lord, there is fear all around us. People are distressed and anxious. And as we try to take control of our circumstances, help us to be a people of peace and hope. Lord, we look to you today. Lead us, we pray. Lord, you are our peace and our hope in all times, including troubled times. Help us to reach out to our families, friends, neighbors, and work colleagues with your hope. Lord, we look to you today. Lead us. We pray. We pray for those infected and for those caring for them. We pray for those living in fear and trepidation, especially including children and the elderly. For those isolated, now even more so, Lord, than before. And we pray for wisdom for all those making decisions. Lord, we look to you today. Lead us, we pray. Loving God, we pray for a cure, simply. We pray for all those working on a vaccine. We pray too for paramedics, doctors, nurses, and all those working tirelessly in our healthcare system. Lord, we look to you today. Lead us, we pray. We pray for those without work, for all those affected financially, travel agents, airline staff, sports people, those working in tourism, supermarkets, schools and venues, and the vulnerable already struggling to make ends meet. Lord, we look to you today. Lead us, we pray. Lord, help us to be wise as a community of faith, to be mindful of each other and all of the others in this situation. Help us to not forget the thousands dying every day from hunger, disease, war, violence, etc. Not just the virus. Lord, we look to you today. Lead us, we pray. as a scared world needs a fearless church. Help us to be a prophetic voice in our communities, drinking from you the living water of grace and forgiveness. Help us to draw together at that well and to reflect your love, compassion, grace, and peace. Lord, we look to you today. Lead us, we pray. Amen.
We called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. How sweet you hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy he brings. But greater still, the calm assurance this child can face uncertain days because he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. I'll cross the river, I'll find life's final war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory and I'll know he lives.
Faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding